The Batteries Included podcast is brought to you with United Chargers. United Chargers presents the Grizzly range of EV chargers. There's the original Grizzly Classic, a powerful, heavy-duty, portable EV charging station built to withstand the toughest conditions. The Grizzly Duo, a dual-port unit designed to charge two vehicles at the same time. The Grizzly Mini, a small, portable charging station built with an indoor-outdoor-rated cast aluminium enclosure. And the Grizzly Smart, a revolutionary smart EV charger. All Grizzly chargers come with a convenient 24-foot cable and the ability to adjust the current from 16 amps all the way up to 40 amps. That's 9.6 kilowatts. Plus, they're IP67 rated. Built in Canada with the highest quality materials, order yours now at unitedchargers.com. That's unitedchargers.com.
Hello, and welcome to the Batteries Included podcast. It's September the 22nd, 2023, and this is episode number 4. Thank you very much for joining us. On today's show, we'll be talking about Toyota turning to Tesla-style megacasting production, the 2024 Audi Q4 E-Tron is getting updated for 2024 in Europe, and renting an electric panel van from Ryder. And of course, much, much more. I'm Domenick, host of the YouTube channel Drive Electric with Domenick. Joining us today is the eminent Mr. Tom Malogny, senior editor at Inside EVs and host of the YouTube channel State of Charge. And we also have the maestro, Mr. Martin Lee from the EV News Daily podcast, which is available on all the best podcast platforms. Good morning and welcome, everybody.
Good morning.
So unfortunately, Kyle Connor from Out of Spec won't be with us this morning. We were supposed to have him, but the last minute cancellation, he's actually in Europe with an automaker, and I guess plans changed at the last minute. And so, right, we're on our own today. Okay. So, Mr. Tom Malogny, last week, let's talk about this Tesla situation, fire situation. Again, we talked about this last week a bit, but you shared some pictures and video of a Tesla Model 3 that caught fire after hitting some road debris. So this week, you put out a video on your own channel about this car, this Carbecue, as I like to say, with lots more details. And you also used it to highlight the difference in vehicle fire numbers between combustion cars and electrics. So last week, we didn't really get into those kind of details at all, you know, just like the general overall situation with fire and electric cars and combustion cars and different things. But you put together some information for this podcast. So I was just wondering, what can you tell us about that?
Okay, yeah. So as I mentioned last week, we didn't really talk about it much last week, but I went over some of the highlights. A good friend of mine is a captain at the Newark Fire Department. And you know, he and I talked about EVs for a while. And of course, he always takes a look at it from the safety perspective, what's related to his job. And electric vehicles are a problem for fire departments. They're very difficult to put out. And so as this was going on, he was like on the scene, but he's a captain. So he wasn't actively working on the fires. He was overseeing things, but he's shooting me pictures and videos and saying, "This thing just keeps going back on fire. We can't put it down." And this is what happens when we do these fires. We put it out, and then 15, 20 minutes later, it starts smoking, smoldering. Then, boom, the flame erupts again. And, you know, he's complaining to me because I'm like Mr. EV around here. You know, he's like, you know, these things are taking up. They put our guys' lives at risk more. They use a lot more resources. And that's one of the things that, you know, when you're management in fire departments or in any business, you're looking at resources a lot. And he's like, this thing costs us, I think he said 5 times more than what it costs the department to put out a combustion vehicle fire for a number of reasons. And it also is more dangerous. The fumes that are emitted are more toxic than the toxic fumes that are emitted from a conventionally fueled vehicle. So, you know, we were talking a lot about this, and that's what inspired me to say, hey, you know, I hate perpetuating the notion that EVs catch on fire more, which they don't. So I really was like, I don't know if I want to do an EV fire video or not. But then I said, well, you know, I'll try to maybe take this as a learning opportunity and talk a little bit about it. So what I did was in the first half of the video, I talked about this Tesla fire and how, you know, every time they knocked it down, it flared back up, and how LFP batteries are a little bit better for fires because they have a higher burning point where they enter thermal runaway, 500 degrees Fahrenheit versus 300 degrees. But I have to mention one thing. I did make a mistake in the video. I said that the Model 3 in the U.S. uses NCM battery packs, you know, the nickel, cobalt, manganese, and they don't. They use that chemistry for different vehicles and in China and so forth, but they use the nickel, cobalt, aluminum oxide for the Model 3 here in the U.S. So I always like to make it a point to correct myself when I make a mistake in the video. But that really wouldn't change anything that I said, because the NCM and the NCA cells act very similarly in fires. It's the LFP that seemed to have a better resistance to thermal runaway and a higher point when it spreads. But you know, so I talked a lot about the fire. Then I went into fire safety and about how EVs, they don't catch on fire more regularly than combustion vehicles. Actually, the data so far is much better than conventionally fueled vehicles, but by an order of magnitude better. But there's one thing that we have to watch out for: those statistics is the combustion vehicles that are in this pool of combustion vehicles that we have, where they can say, you know, a fire for every million EVs on the, or cars on the road. A lot of those vehicles are very old. And we don't have 25-year-old EVs on the road that maybe the wires are starting to wear out or whatever, like what's happening with the combustion vehicles. So I urge people not to take the statistics we have today and say, well, this is, you know, EVs are like 50 times less likely to catch fire than that's my video. I had to do it. If you're watching us on YouTube, my family owned a Ford Pinto in the 70s, and I drove in the back seat of my parents' Ford Pinto for like 6 years. So I had to mention that, you know, I've been living on the edge my whole life. You know, if they'd have known how bad it was back then, we would have never bought a Pinto. But in any event, gas cars do catch on fire more frequently than EVs. But when EVs catch on fire, they're very difficult to put out. Now, the good thing about putting out this video was I got a lot of feedback from followers about new products coming out. Like I talked about how conventional fire blankets don't work, but there's new fire blankets that are hitting the market now, supposed to work better. But you know, in my opinion, they haven't been fully vetted yet. So let's hope that they work better. I don't understand how the fire blanket can prevent thermal runaway, no matter how good the blanket is, because the thermal, when you go into thermal runaway, the cells become like self-sustaining the fires. They create their own oxygen. They create their own heat. I don't know how being under a blanket will stop that. Maybe it'll just contain it. I don't know. But that's one thing. There's another company now that's coming out with this item. I forget the proper terminology, but you have to lift the car a little bit. You wedge it under the car and it shoots. It high pressure water actually penetrates the battery pack like a jet stream. And then it floods the battery pack with water. Now, I'm not sure how that's going to work, because a lot of the battery packs have individual modules that are purposely created so that there won't be intrusion from module to module. So if there's a thermal runaway event, I don't know how you'd have to get the module that's on fire, you know, and I don't know how exactly that's going, but maybe we'll follow up, guys, and do some a midweek show or something in the future and talk about EV fires and about maybe the new technology that's out there helping firefighters fight them better.
But, yeah, one of the things I will ask you about, Tom, is I was really surprised because the comment section of our videos, you know, the old place and over here as well, the comment section is a wonderful place to be. It's full of, I think, pretty sensible grown-up people. What I was surprised about last week, we put the podcast out last week, and immediately some people, I'm in a minority, and I mean like two or three people, but we never really see negative comments on our videos, like we're immediately triggered and being like, you guys are just talking about fires for clicks. You know, you are, you know, you're just doing this for sensationalism. EVs are very safe. And I watched our video back last week at last week's podcast. I've just listened to what you've said. At no point are we trying to scare the general public. Are we over-exaggerating or over-egging the pudding? We're certainly not desperate for clicks on this podcast. Thank you very much. That's not the business model of how we do this. So we're not desperate to get eyeballs on a web page, then sell, you know, flog you sort of some little banner in the side corner. So that's it confused me more than anything. Did you see any feedback in your personal inbox, your personal channel, from people who didn't understand why we were hopefully having a sensible conversation about a real thing? It wasn't saying, oh, imagine if EVs caught fire, let's all imagine what would then happen. It was a real car, a real thing happened. the real family had to deal with this and it's still dealing with the aftermath and insurance companies, I imagine. So why not talk about it? We weren't blowing it out of all proportion, I don't think. Anyway, did you get any of that sort of pushback on your personal channels?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, a lot of the comments I responded to by saying, did you watch the video? You know, because, you know, right. And I think, you know, that I think that's what got some of the people going was that maybe the thumbnail has a picture of a car on fire and everybody feels that you're automatically just putting that up there for clicks. And, you know, there is science to thumbnail, putting thumbnails on. Yes. You know, as you mentioned, we're not dying. We don't get paid per click or anything like that. But, you know, if something will catch somebody's eye, I'm not ashamed of putting that up on my thumbnail if I think it's going to create more drive traffic. But then the content has to live for itself. You know, right, it's actually
pertinent information.
Yeah, yeah. It's actually very bad for our podcast and for, say, YouTube videos to have this awesome, flashy clickbait thumbnail, but then people don't stay long. That's bad. So I would never, and we would never create a thumbnail that led people to our thing only to be disappointed by the content, because then by them leaving quickly, then YouTube says this podcast or this video is something people are not interested in. Everyone that goes on there clicks on the thumbnail, but then they watch for 30 seconds and they leave. So, you know, I think people don't understand really how that works, but I'm not ashamed to say that I'll make a thumbnail that will get someone's attention. And I think that's what some of the comments were, Martin.
Yeah. And I don't think there's any problem talking about the negatives of EVs. I would point out that Tom, you know, you were in the early mini lease program, the early i3 program. You educate people week in, week out on charger safety, which is the best charger to get. Here's how to be safe at home with electrical things. Like, nobody that I know in the United States has done more to sell the benefits of electric vehicles and to help people make the right consumer decisions and than Tom, and over an extended period of time. So some of those comments of, oh no, you guys don't understand, EVs don't catch fire. I'm like, well, we're not trying to blow this out of all proportion. And I felt like, in a way, people trying to shut down the conversation, right, because they didn't agree with the topic matter, that we shouldn't discuss things that are negative around EVs. Look, if the sales numbers go down, like over the last few months, the stock at US dealers has gone up and it actually exceeded ICE vehicles for a period of time. So we talked about that. We talked about how there's no waiting list to buy an EV now and dealers have got some stock. And again, you could think it's a negative story. I don't know if you do or not, but then compare that to the UAW strike of the last week. Well, all of a sudden, the automakers are saying, hey, we built up that stock because we knew we were going to go into protracted period of negotiations and people can still get their cars. So there's two sides to every coin. I was surprised to see people think that we were, in a way, anti-EV by discussing a fire. But I like to have that conversation because we're all grown-ups. I mean, I can disagree with our viewers and still be their friend. That's okay. So I thought that was interesting. Apart from that, really fascinating discussion. I know I learned a lot from your video, Tom. And I think it's, why not? Let's talk about the negatives as well as the positives.
Yeah, exactly. And let's pull up Anders' comment that just made. So the narrative from fossil fuel lobbies is danger. So don't feed that narrative if not important. Fires in cars are a non-story. So Anders, the reason why I chose to discuss this and continue to discuss it is because, and while what you say, I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying, the fact that there are a lot of people out there that believe EVs are more dangerous, yeah, because they catch on fire more frequently. So by us by avoiding it, we're not helping to dispel that myth. The myth is that EVs burst into fire. They're going to burn down your house. You know what? That's going to happen. I mean, on occasion, every type of, you store a lot of energy in any way to store it, right, and it's going to combust at some point. But we need to offset the FUD and explain that, yeah, this is going to happen. But look, the data out there shows that it's going to happen less frequently. And as a matter of fact, when an EV fire happens, typically you have more time to get out of the vehicle safely than you do with a combustion vehicle. So, you know, we have to point these things out. We can't just say, oh, it's a non-story, so we're not going to cover it. You know, I don't think that's doing the industry a service.
Yeah, I was in the same boat as Anders this week, by the way, when the UK government pushed back the 2030 to 2035 date. And the world went nuts about it. And actually, I was in the same boat as Anders at the time. I was like, stop talking about it, because it doesn't matter. Like, it just feeds this narrative of EVs are doomed. So, and I took a step back and thought, actually, it is an important topic. You have got to discuss it. So I know where he's coming from with that. I was like, everyone stop talking about it. Because I think we'll be mostly EV by 2030 anyway in this country.
Right. I was going to bring that up.
We're 20-25% already. So
right. And just real quick, Martin, what was it, the 2030 to 2035, what was exactly that was changed there? So just 3 years for people who don't know.
Yeah, so 3 years ago, we said UK is going in 2030, the all new vehicle sales, no one's taking away your petrol car that you bought on New Year's Eve on 2029. You can drive it for 15 years till 2045. But from 2030, all new passenger vehicles must have a reasonable amount of battery range. At the time, 3 years ago, our government and the ministers didn't want to put a number on that. I think there was probably intense lobbying from the likes of Toyota, who make sort of mild hybrids, that, oh, actually, you know, our car can get to the end of the road 100 meters. That should be enough. So I'm sure there was lobbying. They never, ever enshrined it in stone what significant battery mileage is. I suggested 100 miles. By 2030, battery technology should be, I've got a plug-in hybrid, it can do 100 miles. That would be cool. And then this week, our prime minister, there's loads of issues around this, by the way, because we don't have a presidency, so the prime minister should have presented his plan to parliament first, with a parliamentary system. He didn't. He did like a presidential style speech. I gather that's now being investigated and looked at. He may be hauled over the coals for that. He is maybe 15 points behind his competitor, the opposition leader, desperate to find any political embers that he can try and stir. And I think he just thought, look, there are some people out there who hate EVs, so I'll do this big fancy speech. We're putting it back to 2035. And we're saving hardworking families money. Well, look, hard work, you know, if you're paying your bills week to week, you're not buying new cars, are you? Like, I don't buy new cars. So I don't care about the price of a new EV. I care about the price of an EV that's second, third, fourth hand. And if we stifle EVs now in 2030, there won't be any second, third, fourth hand ones. He's actually doing the opposite. And he hurt hardworking families buying cars the way they buy them. Because if you've got no money, you're not buying a brand new car, are you? So the whole thing was a mess. It just got torn apart. Ford was brilliant, by the way. And I haven't got it in front of me, but Ford just ripped into him. And it was brilliant. Just took him apart. And I was
Ford,
like, whoa.
Ford Motor Company?
That was punchy. Yeah. I'm going to bring it up because it's brilliant. So we are now in line with the European Union, which is always 2035. Will it matter? No, he's going to lose next year. We'll either get an opposition government or a coalition government of sort of Labour, Lib Dems, Greens, or maybe completely Labour government, either way. And they've already said, if we win, we're putting it straight back in and we'll define what significant. It could be 20 miles or 50 miles, but just put a number on it and all the car makers will find a way to do it. And I could not find a single, that's a lie, Toyota came out and said they agree with it, it's pragmatic. All the car makers, Stellantis ripped into it, Ford, Kia were a little more reserved in the language. They call it like disappointing that the UK isn't consistent.
Disappointing is a strong word in corporate speak, though.
Yeah, right. You know? So let me find that for you, and I'll put it up on screen in a moment.
Disappointed. but to your point, though, I mean, it's very likely that these dates don't matter at this point because, you know, automakers already have, you know, a timeline in their heads when they think they have, because not just the UK's laws, but also the EU and like California, and, you know, we're kind of, it's like a, you can't really stop this train at this point. It's kind of headed that way. And with the speed that, you know, people, I mean, that the electric vehicles are improving and the less value that internal combustion cars will hold, you know, over their lifetime is decreasing, you know, as EVs get better. It's kind of set in sand or set in stones. One of those two things.
Ford made a good comment, but I'll read their final paragraph. Okay. This is the biggest industry transformation in over a century, and the UK 2030 target is a vital catalyst to accelerate Ford into a cleaner future. Our business needs three things from the UK government: ambition, commitment, and consistency. A relaxation of 2030 would undermine all three. Wow. And that's exactly what our prime minister did. And Ford are spending billions. It was a pretty, it was a stern statement. And the crazy thing is, industry came out as well, like the Chamber of Commerce, and they all kind of came out and was like, 3 years ago, you gave the auto industry a cast iron guarantee. Like BMW have just done a big deal with the Swindon Mini plant. And from what people tell me, and I don't know if this is true or not, but this is what people in the auto industry told me, as negotiations were being finalized recently, the UK government were giving them a cast iron guarantee. They would not be walking back 2030. And a week later, I mean, if you're in the BMW boardroom and you see that, I would be calling whoever you deal with in the UK government and to be like, you told me this. Now, look, it's a 600 million investment. It's not billions that BMW are putting into the Mini plant. And there is some government money chipped in as well. But the car makers just took their breath away because they're like, but you just keep telling us you're not going to move it. And you did just, and what everybody said, it was just to get votes. And it's not even going to work. And will it matter? No. Will it slow down the move to EVs? As Dom says, no. But if I was a CFO at a major car company and I'm signing off big checks, these are real jobs that they're playing with to get votes. And I didn't like that at all. I'm not massively into talking about politics, but that annoyed me because you are really messing. And you know what? It was aimed at people who are not perhaps as literate in this topic because they also cancelled. They walked back previous promises on how we'll make our new build homes better. How because the UK actually has the leakiest new homes in Europe. We need to fix that, right? It's costing a fortune for our energy bills and you know, insulation. They walked all of those things back as well. And you know what? It was a cynical attempt to appear more popular. And what annoys me is it's aimed at those who are the least literate in this subject. And it's what all of us, I think, this podcast tries to do is to help. Like just raise that level of understanding of electric vehicles, renewable storage, all those kind of things. And we all learn stuff together. And everybody who has like a modicum of knowledge of this subject just spoke out against it. And it was, will it matter? No. But at the time I said, oh, can we all stop talking about this? It won't matter. And then I thought, well, actually, no, that's the wrong thing to say. We do need to have that conversation as I've just done.
So just to circle back around again and to talk about it, these numbers that Tom found, you know, are pretty impressive. So I just wanted to mention them, although, as he said, they're not like, you know, there's a lot of other considerations to take into account. But so the National Fire Protection Agency reports that there are roughly 170,000 car fires every year. For every 100,000 electric vehicles, there are about 25 fires per year. And then for the same 100,000 combustion vehicles, there are 1,530 fires per year. So that works out to be like 61 times more fires in combustion vehicles, which is, you know, crazy number. And you know, not one that you want to take to the bank for any length of time, because as Tom was saying, like the combustion cars, that's an older fleet, and so they're more likely to run into situations where they're going to catch on fire. And we should remember too that car fires aren't necessarily started by the battery or by the gasoline in the gas tank leaking out somewhere. There's a hundred different ways things can go wrong and stuff burn down. So it's not necessarily an indictment on the power system so much. And I mean, Maybe there is a big difference between them, but just with this rough kind of data, it's hard. You can't really see that for now. Yeah. So I just wanted to throw that out there.
Also, I saw a comment here from someone who from Rich Morris. So our prime minister also said he will never allow seven different garbage bins outside every home to split your recycling into seven bins, and there will be no tax on meat. And somebody had to point out they weren't policies. So someone's written his speech for him, and then I don't know who, you know, I think it was the BBC were the first to fact check it and go, no one has ever suggested seven bins or taxing meat. And it annoyed me because I enjoy watching American politics because it's entertaining and Trump entertains me. And it was like, it was a very close to home moment of a person in charge just spouting nonsense. And I'm like, oh, I don't like it when it affects me. Like when we've got a leader that is just talking, just making stuff up. And I'm like, hang on, I don't like it now. So yeah, it was a silly week.
Right on. So anything else you want to add? We might do another show on this, like a standalone show, possibly, I think, what we're talking about. Maybe, Tom?
Yeah, I think it's worth it. I think it's worth exploring. Maybe we could have my friend who's a captain on. Maybe we can contact the companies that are developing some new EV fire equipment products, like the fire blanket and the other thing I mentioned that injects the water. I think we'll do a midweek show on this coming up sometime soon.
All right. Yeah, it sounds good to get some facts out there and see where all, you know, fire people, you know, have obviously a large stake in this and concern. And also there's, like you said, there's a just different firefighting technology coming up that, you know, we need to learn about. So before we move on to the news, I just want to talk about my little video channel this week. So I did a video. So it's been a while since I've done this. So I have a used Tesla Model 3. It was a 2018 I bought earlier this year, and it's got full self-driving beta, full in quotes, full self-driving beta. Right now it has version 11.4.7. So this week, it's been a while since I've got this test loop in town. It's just like a circuit that has a bunch of just challenging sort of turns and situations. And so so I picked up my friend Ashley here. You can see her if you're watching this on YouTube. And we went for a little drive to, I call it the Dude Loop. It's like the acronym for my channel, Drive Electric with Domenick. So we went on a little tour of the Dude Loop, and it started up really good. So I hadn't been on this software really yet on FSD. And it started out, it was, you know, things were going quite well, actually. We took a little bit of a different road, actually, at the first part of it, but it still did things pretty good until about halfway. And then it just kind of fell on its face, man. It had phantom braking. It stops for a yield sign when entering a traffic circle with nothing coming. And this was something that it used to do before, too, and it hasn't improved. Actually, it did improve the first traffic circle I hit, which is closer to my place. It handled that one just fine. It was great. But it's a small one, but it's the one in the closer to downtown. It just, you know, stops. And then after that, it's like, it wouldn't go the speed limit. It grew up and the speed limit is like, I think 25, maybe 30 miles an hour there. And I had to keep, you know, giving the accelerator just to keep it moving along, because there's people coming up behind you. You know, you don't want to hold up traffic. And then that's close to the very end, I had to make a naked left turn. And so unprotected turn, there's no light. And so there was a couple cars coming and the car pulls out. We had there's nothing coming on the right, just on the left, you know, two cars. It's a four lane street there. And the car pulls out, but it's like slow. It's like I had to really come onto the accelerator really quickly, because they would have had to slam on their brakes or run into me. It was so concerning. I'm going to, I think, run that same loop again just by myself today or tomorrow. And so I can just give, because when I have a passenger in the car, we're talking sometimes. So it's hard to relay all the information that's happening with the car. Because sometimes, you know, it's hard to see on camera sometimes, like the little slowdowns and just kind of weird, maybe pulls to the left or right, it'll do. I'm going to do another loop of that. So if you're curious about FSD, you know, check that out. But let's move on to some news. So this week, Toyota recently held an informational session called Toyota Monozukuri Workshop. Monozukuri means manufacturing. Mono is thing. Zukuri is like making. Under the theme of changing the future of car making. And they put a big press release about it. So not super, super interesting unless you're really a car manufacturing nerd, but there were some interesting points. So in amongst the talk of increasing mechanization and using high gloss plastics to avoid painting and laser processing to achieve sharp character lines, there was a section about the next generation battery electric vehicle demonstration line. So here we learn that Toyota is taking a page from Tesla's innovation book and doing what it's calling Gigacasting. So if you're watching this on YouTube, you can see this three-piece of a vehicle here. There's a front section, a middle section, and a rear section. So they showed off this three-part modular structure that are brought together to form the chassis of the vehicle, and then demonstrated the process for journalists. So the rear module takes about this, like the metal part underneath it. In the picture here, we see it with a seat and tires, but just like the metal structure, substructure, it takes about 30 seconds to make with this casting method they're using. So the molten aluminum is poured into molds and rapidly cooled from like 700 to 250 degrees Celsius, solidify into a single die-cast piece, making up the entire rear third of the vehicle chassis. So this is normally built from 86 different parts in like a 33-step process that takes hours. So 30 seconds is a huge, obviously, improvement. But this seems a little different from what Tesla does. So in the photo of the area where the casting happens, it's on the Toyota Media website. I'm not sure if we have access to that right away, but we don't really see like the big high-pressure die-casting machines like that Tesla is using. Those things apply like 50 to 60,000 kilotons of force. So I'm not sure, but if I could be wrong here, but Toyota's approach seems to be a little less dramatic than that. I'm not really sure what the, and they talk about reusing molds in their press release. They're talking about reusing molds where the Tesla process, I don't think those are like really expensive molds. I think that they need to use for a long time. It takes a really while. They're very complex and it takes quite a while and expense to make them. So I don't know. But see, there's some other interesting parts of this presentation as well. There was like just a solid state battery and bipolar battery development lines. So not a whole lot of like details. We don't really see like cells spinning around, you know, the manufacturing, you know, machinery there, but it's just looks like an inside of a car manufacturing plant. But they do have, I guess, you know, these battery production lines are developing that technology to make these new batteries, which are, you know, are going to be good steps forward, I believe, if they're successful. So, Tom, do you find it's a sign that the mighty Toyota and its widely touted production system is actually learning from a young automaker like Tesla?
So, yeah, I think everybody to some degree is learning from Tesla. You know, whether they won't admit that, but you know, this startup Silicon Valley company came out of nowhere and literally it transformed the industry, you know, where, you know, they time and time again, they did things that everybody said wasn't possible. And, you know, I criticize Tesla a lot, but there's a lot of things that they deserve to be criticized for. But there's also things we have to celebrate that, you know, they went out and just changed the way cars are made even now. And well, first, the biggest thing was that they proved that EVs could be, you know, viable, long range, fast charging vehicles, which everybody says was just impossible in the industry at the time. But to the point with structural battery pack and these giga castings, even the streamlined interiors where, you know, everything is simplicity, which, you know, you might not like, but you notice everybody's following that path now, whether they admit it or not. I won't say everybody, but a lot of manufacturers are kind of replicating Tesla's interior where everything is minimalistic with this big screen that does everything in the middle. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think that Tesla has influenced Toyota. I'm not going to try to go deeper into that and say that, well, this isn't as good as what Tesla's doing because they say it could be reused and Tesla can't. I'm not Sandy Monroe. I don't really understand the full, you know, manufacturing effects of the giga castings and how they're made. You could always, you know, guess on it, but it would be a pure guess. I just know for a fact, you know, to answer your question, your quick question with a long answer was absolutely Tesla has influenced Toyota and everybody else. And that's a good thing. They've shaken up the industry and told everybody, you don't have to do things the way you always did them. You don't have to make these tiny incremental improvements on manufacturing like we've been doing, you know, for the last 100 years. We're just making it slightly better, slightly better, slightly better. You could just tear all that up, start with a clean sheet of paper, and you can actually make something better, which Tesla's done. So yeah, it's definitely Tesla influenced here, which is a great thing for the industry.
Justin Herman brings up a good question, and I've seen this asked a lot in a lot of places. With such big castings, what happens to insurance costs? A minor accident could write off the vehicle. And that's a, you know, it makes sense. It's a concern that people definitely have, and I've seen it a lot of places. But from what I can tell, though, the reactions that I've seen is people in the industry, in the auto repair, in the auto body shop repair industry, I don't see a whole lot of concern. I think they can kind of deal with that, you know, to a certain extent. I don't know, Tom, have you seen anything about this?
Well, you know, I have heard, and I do believe that insurance rates will increase. Okay. With more electric vehicle proliferation, because it does seem that more minor incidences are totaling vehicles, you know, and I noticed that when I had my i3 back in the beginning, it had that CFRP frame. I got T-boned on the side at an intersection, and I don't think it would have been totaled if it was a different vehicle of conventional manufacturing, but my CFRP frame was cracked and that's it. You're done. You're totaled. And, you know, we've seen that with EVs, you know, where it doesn't look like the vehicle is that badly damaged, but then you find out, well, it impacted the battery tray or whatever. And it's like, okay, it's totaled. So if that becomes more and more prevalent, then yeah, insurance rates, I mean, they have to go up, because if a more minor incident is going to total a vehicle, the insurance companies all go on statistics. You know, if more vehicles are getting totaled, your insurance rates are going to go up. So I think that's going to happen. But if you want to go long-term, you know, I think as we eventually get into self-driving vehicles, you know, which I don't believe is going to happen in this decade, but, you know, let's say, I hope I'm wrong. At some point, we're going to remove the insurance component of it. We won't be paying for insurance. It'll either be self-insured because the manufacturer or who's ever responsible for the self-driving features will insure it, or the insurance rates will go down so much because so many vehicle incidents will be eliminated because of the tech getting better and better. So I do see over the course of the next 5 years or so, 5 to 6, 7 years, I think insurance rates are going to go up overall.
It could go different ways then. Interesting. All right. I don't know if we want to touch on any more of this. I think the president of Lexus, Takashi Watanabe, has said something similar about, you know, not necessarily copying Tesla, but, you know, giving them props and, you know, letting the world know they're kind of like taking notes, you know, making improvements and not afraid to admit it, I guess. And they have some new concepts coming up this fall, I think, for the new modular sort of approach to electric vehicles. They're still in their, I don't even know what to say about what they're doing, Martin.
I mean, Toyota have got the problem that they're doing too well, and there's no push for Toyota, the board, the, you know, the accountants that run the place, that run all big companies. Is that there's no real push at Toyota to take any risks and to rock the boat, because they're still selling so many vehicles and they're still doing really, really well. And we talk about on this podcast, and our listeners and viewers always try and be looking ahead in 3, 5, 10 years' time. What could the world look like? Well, if I was Toyota and I was there and I was doing really well, I think, well, you know, we're doing just fine. Thanks. You know, have you looked at how many cars we're selling at the minute? We don't need you to lecture us on whether we have any electric vehicles on the market or not. I like to think of companies like Apple in cases like this, because they were genuinely a really big company back in the early 80s. It was just them and IBM, really. And people always make the comparison between Elon Musk and Steve Jobs. And I get that, because they're such high profile leaders. They're so different in so many ways, though, I think. If you look at the company Apple, they were so successful. They were just there was no reason for them to carry on innovating and changing and taking risks. And in the end, they moved Steve Jobs aside to be sort of chairman, which doesn't really do much. And then they fired him and you know, did a sort of a hostile takeover, and the board backed the CEO and not him. And then look what happened. Then he went away and did Next and Pixar, which is, you know, amazing what he put his own money into Pixar and created some beautiful art in the world. And Steve Jobs was, you know, an incredible creator that wanted to, you know, make the world better. And when he came back to Apple, Apple was properly broken. I remember, so I was born, 78? So I was kind of in tech in the early 90s. And like, they had a ton of products. You didn't really know what Apple stood for, and they were just in real problems. But they still had all the ability to cut. You know, they bought Next, and Steve Jobs came back into Apple. He simplified things, and he put that sort of engineering, that mindset back into Apple. And look at where they are now. And I think his influence still runs through so many bits of Apple. So I like to look at companies like that rather than the ones that failed. Because people say Toyota are going to be BlackBerry, and you know, Toyota are these all these companies that. Kodak and stuff like that. I'm not sure they are. They're too big and they got too many good people there for Toyota to fail. But I wonder if they need to have just have some tough years where they go, oh, we're getting our butts kicked here, to come back really strong, make some great electric vehicles. Because it's sort of easy, isn't it, to say, oh, Toyota are going to be a dinosaur and go extinct. And I don't think they will. But at the minute, it's easy to do these press releases to say, oh, solid state batteries, hydrogen. And that doesn't really mean anything, does it? And they haven't really got to deliver anything because they're doing so well.
Right.
I don't wish them ill, but they almost do need to go through 5-10 years.
This does seem like a course correction, though. You know, like they've come to the realization that, you know, the path they were headed on with the last CEO, Mr. Toyota, isn't the way forward. And it looks like they're really taking a, you know, correcting and going a little deeper into electric vehicles, a little more aggressively. Yeah. But
I don't know, Dom, they're just talking a good game at this point. I mean, I know they're going to, and they're showing some things, but I don't really see that big of a difference, you know, personally, okay. But let's see. They've been talking a good game for a long time. And, right. You know, and sorry to cut you off, but I did. going back to Martin's point, you know, they really are doing well, and they're kicking ass on selling hybrids. Mm. And, you know, it's like, that's their bread and butter. And we've talked about this before. We've talked about the innovator's dilemma. That's a really interesting book out there. It just... Toyota has really just cornered the market in hybrids. And I know a lot of companies make hybrids, but nobody sells hybrids like Toyota. They dominate the world market, not just Europe, not just the US, the world market. They dominate in hybrids. So they're holding on to that hybrid technology with their death grip, and they do not want to give it up. And they're going to hold on to it as long as they can. And as Martin said, I don't even know if that's necessarily a bad business strategy. It might be the right thing for them to do. We don't want to hear this, you know, and especially the people that are concerned with, you know, which we all should be, global warming and emissions and everything. But, you know, these companies, their number one priority is make money, is to make money and make money for their stockholders and all this. So in that regard, this may be the best move for them. Right now, is it a good long-term strategy? Will they be able to flick that switch, which they believe they can? Toyota believes when the world is ready for electric vehicles, like worldwide, everybody wants them, we can just flip this switch and we'll make the best vehicles because we know how to do this. We have more battery information and history than even Tesla, you know, and we've got this. And, you know, so we'll keep telling you what we're going to do down the road, and we're working on solid state, and we're working on these castings, and we're getting the manufacturing ready. And when that time comes, guys, watch out for us. Let's see if they can, the software is going to be a big issue, because that's becoming such a big part of our vehicles now, how the HMI, the human machine interface, how we interact with the vehicles through the software stack. So even a fantastic vehicle, you know, can be plagued if the software isn't what the customer expects. I mean, look at the ID4. I think the ID4 is a great little car. Not even little. It's a great car, great family mover. But it's been plagued by the fact that customers were not happy with the software. So let's see. Time will tell.
Yeah. Yeah, I think even on their own territory, I think Toyota needs to wake up. Like BYD just launched the Dolphin EV in Japan. And so that's a shot across the bow, really, you know. And China's really come a long ways on auto manufacturing, and specifically electric vehicles. And they have some, you know, really incredible platforms coming and vehicles coming to Europe and soon to the US. The EX30, the Volvo EX30, that's on a Chinese platform, the Geely SEA platform. Yeah. So
the that Dolphin sells for about 25,000 US equivalent in Japan, which is
a good price.
It's a really good price for what
it's like. Very competitive.
It's a bolt size vehicle, isn't it? You know, it's a family car. Yeah.
Yeah, but bigger than a regular the K car. They have those KEI.
Oh yeah.
It's a little bigger than those things actually, but but still small enough, so it could be very popular there, especially at that price point. Mm. Should be interesting to watch. But we should move on, I guess, a little bit.
I got to put Nicholas's comment on here because it's so true. me slipping and calling the ID4 a little car. I know it's so, as I'm looking at my F-150 Lightning on one side and Rivian R1S on the other side. Yeah, there's a bolt nestled in the middle of the two of those. You almost can't see it. So, but yeah, you're right. Good point, Nicholas. You got me there.
Yeah.
All right. So I wanted to touch again on that run on less real world commercial electric truck testing that's currently underway. We talked about this a little bit last week, but so today is day 12 of 18 days of this testing. And there are already a number of interesting observations being made. So last week we mentioned that a Tesla Semi had managed over 800 miles in a day. Well, since then, we've seen a trio of Tesla Semis put over 2,400 miles down on the same day.
Same day?
Each together, like commute. Oh. Like if you look at this.
That's what speed they drive it.
No. You can't drive 2,400 miles in a 24-hour period of time.
Wait a minute. You haven't presented that challenge to Kyle yet.
No, I was going
to
say you can do it. So that's like 700 and something miles a day. That's amazing.
Right. So one truck did 840 miles, 841 miles on this chart. Another did 726 and another did 821 miles.
Wow.
And that's sharing. So that's three trucks and they shared two chargers to do this. They had each had availability of three chargers, but I'm not sure. Maybe. But anyway, there was no overlap. They managed to do all this on a minimal amount of charging equipment, which is good. And they're also getting by on 750 kilowatt chargers, which they mentioned the people running this test are, you know, talk about this being a positive thing because 750 kilowatts is using that instead of the 1.5 megawatts that's going to be coming out eventually. You're going to have a lot less demand charges if you're only asking for half of the power at any given time. So it's just another consideration with commercial charging. And actually, we have an episode coming up next week, midweek, an episode with some people from Terawatt Charging, who is doing a commercial vehicle, basically a charging network, but also not just like a public one, but like really geared toward commercial vehicles to start. But yeah, tune in next week and we'll tell you more about that.
So they're charging these at 750. So the Tesla standard can do a megawatt charging. The Charin backed megawatt charger can do 3 megawatts at its peak. At its peak, arguing, well, we need 3 megawatts of charging for commercial vehicles. And you know, we're charging commercial vehicles here on 750 kilowatts. Still chunky, but they're getting by on that for this use case. I'm not saying we don't need the megawatt charging standard, but Tesla seem to be doing, and there's a bit of headroom there on the Tesla connector because we gather that can go up to a megawatt as well. So that's interesting.
Well, I was just going to say real quick. Once we have chargers along the highway where just any truck owner operator can pull into and fill up, they might want to have the full 3 megawatts available. They don't care about demand charges, and those stations should hopefully have battery storage to avoid causing huge spikes in the demand from their local grid. So sorry to cut you off there, Tom.
No, not at all. I deserved it anyway. So I think Tesla's 750 kilowatt mega chargers are supposed to recharge the Semi from 5 to 80% in exactly an hour. And in this test, in Geotab's data, it showed that they were able to charge the vehicle from 18 to 80% in 55 minutes. So it's very close to what Tesla's claiming. So this backs up, Tesla's claim on how quickly that the Semi can get recharged on these 750 kilowatt mega chargers. So, that's not a bad stop under an hour getting up to 80%.
It's really, I think, from what I'm reading the comments and the different from the different people involved with this, who are not necessarily electric vehicle, you know, fanatics or anything. I think that it's opening up a lot of eyes about the abilities of electric vehicles, electric, you know, tractor trailers, commercial vehicles, to really do the job, you know, that a lot of people were expecting that hydrogen would do, say. And yeah, so that's, it's kind of a, I think it's going to be a pretty big deal this year. And I really can't wait till this thing is all over. Maybe we can get some people who are involved with this program on the show as well to talk with us.
Lucky to get this data. This is just fantastic. This whole project is so good to see. And I've not really been on top of it as much as we could have been. So let's, yeah, if somebody wants to come on the podcast and fill us in and how it's, and how they're doing with runonless.com.
Yeah, runonless.com. Definitely go check it out. If you're into geeking out on data, there's a lot of data, a lot of different kind of vehicles, a lot of different trucks. And their patterns over the different days. We, if you're watching this on YouTube, Martin is playing with some their screen there. You can see, just select the different days, the different depots, because there's different, I think there's 10 different companies involved with a different assortment of vehicles. And yeah, you can see their battery charge, their speed over the day, how much, what speed they traveled most of the time.
So over 50 miles an hour. That's brilliant. Yeah,
right.
That's great. This is fantastic data. We're so lucky to get this. This is a real insight.
Yeah. And this is really the first independent test, right, of the semi.
Like real world. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. And this, and the semi, I think it was really kind of like, I would say, the peak class 8 tractor right now, but just because it has the largest battery, really. And, you know, obviously it works pretty well. I mean, we have the EKSKD out there as well. And that's, you can see how it's doing on these charts. But I think right now the Tesla semi is really kind of setting the standard for class 8 tractors.
Cool stuff.
Mm. Yeah. All right. So let's move on real quick. So we do have some product news this week as well, but not for vehicles coming to the US, at least not yet quite. But the Audi Q4 e-tron has got a bit of a mechanical refresh for 2024, and it's going to be coming to the US at some point. Because we've seen some of these elements in other parts of the Volkswagen group. So basically, the Q4 will become more powerful, more efficient, have more range, higher charging power, faster charge times, more standard features, and improved driver assistance systems. I'm getting a call from my vet. Awesome.
You should see a regular doctor, though.
I know. I had fleas, and so, you know, who do you call? So now in the Audi Q4, the rear motor in Europe, they're getting the AP550. That's the new rear motor for this car. It's a permanently excited synchronous motor. It puts up 282 horsepower, and we've seen this in a number of different Volkswagen Group vehicles now, including, I think, the i7, which is a lot bigger than this. So with this new motor, the Q4 is said to offer 349 miles of range in the WLTP cycle. That's up from 332 in the 77 from the 77 kilowatt hour usable battery. It's the same battery, 82 gross, I believe, 77 usable. And of course, the acceleration improves as well, with the rear wheel drive going from 0 to 62 miles an hour in 6.7 seconds. The top dual motor quattro Q4 e-trons can get to up to 62 miles an hour in as little as 5.4 seconds, which is plenty quick for, you know, a nice family crossover SUV. So they say they've optimized the cell chemistry of the pack and can now DC charge from 10 to 80% in 28 minutes, which is it's still about like 10 minutes slower than like an EGMP platform car from Hyundai, but it's definitely not the slowest. I think that's puts it kind of in the realm of, you know, manageable expectations. I think 28 minutes to 80%. Prices in it's going to be 52,950 euros in Germany. That's the equivalent of 56,400 here. That's before incentives, I believe. And Audi does not say when the US market will get the updated Q4, but I don't know, Colin, do you remember if the ID, we talked about this recently with the ID4, right? They're getting the AP550 here now or for 2024.
Yeah, I don't know exactly when. Kyle was talking to them directly about this, you know, and he's been really the one saying how much, how greatly improved it is. So unfortunately, I don't know exactly when it's coming. But the funny thing is that you mentioned that I had a friend of mine reach out to me yesterday and ask me when's the ID4 going to get that, because he's interested in getting an ID4 soon. And he's like, I want to make sure that I don't get one with the old software stack. I think he was more concerned about the software, you know, right. and getting the new software than the motor. I mean, the ID4, I know it has more power than the previous version, but to me, that car, like, it was fine driving out as it was. Every EV doesn't have to be a barn burner. For the use case of them, for 95% of the people, the current ID4 had more than enough power, in my opinion.
When I drove the rural drive version of the ID4 with the older motor, I was a little underwhelmed with the acceleration. I really wanted a bit more. I was driving my Spark EV at the time, which was super juicy off the line, and this was like not that. But now with this new motor, I would go rear-wheel drive, even though the all-wheel drive is going to be quicker, but the dual motor is going to have plenty of juice. And then you still get to keep your long range and also that awesome turning radius that the rear-wheel drive version of the ID4 has. You know, it's just amazing in town.
I agree with you, but you have to understand, you're coming from the perspective of driving EVs all the time, these powerful instant torque vehicles. The vast majority of ID4 owners now, the buy or lease one, are coming from a comparable ICE vehicle. And the ID4 as it is more peppy, better acceleration, more torque, more instant acceleration. So they're already going to feel like it's an improvement. That's my perspective on it.
That's a good point.
Clarify this, Dom. Is it a case that they haven't updated the single motor version, or they have? Because the single motor, the rear wheel drive version, stays at 135 kilowatts peak. Then it's the dual motor that comes with the new software, the bigger screen, the 175 kilowatt peak charging speed. But you said that they put the new AP550 motor on the rear wheel drive vehicle, and yet on the rear wheel drive, they seem to have not updated the small screen, the old software, and the old charging speed. And that's not a motor thing. That's a battery thing. So I was a little confused about this story in terms of have they not. They seem to have touched the rear wheel drive a little bit. But if you want all the juicy updates and the 175 kilowatt charge speed, peak at least, then you want the dual motor. And that's got the big screen and the fancy software.
I'm looking at the article here on Inside EVs, and it says equipped with a new motor, the Audi Q4 Sportback 45 e-tron is said to offer a range of up to 349 miles of range in the WLTP cycle, up from 332. So I believe those gains are from the single motor
wheel drive. Yeah. So that is the motor. But I wonder why the charge speed has stayed the same for the single motor, 135 kilowatt peak. But for the dual motor, you get the big screen, the fast charge. Look, you want the dual motor version. My problem with the Audi Q4 was it was too much like the ID4, because, you know, we would tell our listeners and viewers in a kind of shorthand way, it's, you know, it's like the ID, you know, they're like a Volkswagen, it's Audi's version. A bit like we say, well, the kind of the Cupra Born was their version of the ID3, except the Born was really, really good and looked fantastic and actually felt really different inside. My problem with the Q4 as it was it felt too much like Audi had, I'm not going to say rebadged and be that insulting to the Audi engineers. It just felt too close to a VW ID. It just didn't feel Audi enough. The materials inside didn't feel. Then again, the material choice of the early VWs was pretty bad, and they've changed that with the midlife refresh. So I think if Audi can Audify it, sort out the ride, sort out to make it feel more like just more premium, because it's not a cheap car, very premium vehicle. That was my issue with this. Mechanically, I thought it was always all right. They just needed to tweak it and be a bit more Audi. Maybe this is what it's all about.
Yeah. It's going to be nice to see it over here. I still haven't driven the Audi Q4 e-tron, and I need to do that. So maybe I might hold off until we get to the spicy ones, because spicy. let's talk about another car, a new car. It's just pricing and specs. Fiat revealed for the 600e. So 600e is a new model they're bringing back from I believe the last time they made it was in 2010, but this time it's all it's all electric, but it's on the ECMP2 platform, which is it shares with the Jeep Avenger. So they can put a hybrid in there too if they want to make a plug-in hybrid vehicle with it. But for now, they're starting off with all electric, and so it's like you might imagine by from the name, it's like larger than the 500e. But it still shares a strong familial resemblance to that car. The battery is 54 kilowatt-hours gross, 51 kilowatt-hours usable, and it's rated for 250 miles on the WLTP combined cycle. Interesting here is it might be especially more efficient at lower speeds because Fiat claims it can get up to 375 miles in the city as measured by the WLTP urban cycle. Charging wise, it goes from 0 to 80% in 30 minutes, which is great. It's right up in there. So, Martin, how is this car being received over there? Because this is really a European vehicle, right?
Yeah, I don't think it has been received by the general public very well yet. It's not a well-known car. Like the Fiat 500, it's not that level of awareness in the wider public. But I think, if you're a Fiat buyer or family buyer, and but the same can be said for Jeep here as well. Reminder that to our US viewers that the name Jeep here, it's a name. Obviously, we think of it as being in the trenches and, you know, wartime and all that kind of stuff. Like, Jeep is a legendary name. The Jeep has less than 1% kind of share in that segment that they sell in. So they will probably do pretty well with the Avenger because it looks pretty good. The magazine, the car magazines are raving about the Jeep. And really? I think the automotive websites have been pretty generous to this Fiat 600 as well. Not a huge car for the general buyers, but so that the specs on this: 54 kilowatt hour gross, 51 kilowatt hour usable. You said 250 miles on the WLTP test cycle, which is probably all right, depending on your use case. 32,995 is probably about right. £33,000 seems about right. I mean, all new car prices seem too high in my head, but that's just like anytime I see a price of a new car, I'm like, is that what a new car costs these days? So it seems expensive.
Well, low 30 sounds good though. When I think about European or UK prices, when I hear like those lower 30, I'm like, okay, that's for over there, that's pretty decent, right?
It's yeah. Like,
high 20s here.
I guess so. But I think all of the personality, if I was Fiat, where are we? Let me bring up the front of the car. If I was them, I'd just use the front in the publicity pictures because it's not a great looker, but the front has all of the personality with those headlights that are half closed or sort of, you know, giving you side eye. All of the personality at the front end with this kind of, I don't know, fish mouth here.
The profile is a bit more pedestrian.
But the front end is where all the action is. I'd use all these pictures. We'll wait and see what it sells for, but it seems about right. Yeah,
is this upmarket from the Jeep Avenger, do you think, or about the same?
No, we don't think of Fiat as a treat yourself, get a Fiat.
Right, but I mean, do you think the Jeep will be above it in the market, you think, as far as like perception quality? Or
yeah, they are
going, charge more for it, basically.
Yeah, because the Jeep has got that styling to make it look like it's more of a crossover, wanting to be an SUV than it really is. And I do like the styling of the Jeep. They are kind of playing into that whole kind of, hey, want to drive up the side of a mountain? You need a Jeep. It's like, you'd get stuck in a muddy field in most cars, but it's not a Range Rover. So I think they're Jeep are leaning into that side, which is probably smart actually for the marketing of that car. which is interesting because it will never, ever go anywhere near the side of a mountain, and it couldn't cope with one. But whereas the Fiat, well, they're, you know, they, funnily enough, they do play into the whole, you know, Italian fun. Certainly with the Fiat 500, they really lean into right. that with their marketing over here. And you know, and fair play, they're not being stereotypical, but it is, you know, they do sort of lean into that. So wonder what they'll do with this. I like it.
Got a word there, Martin? Or Martin, Tom, sorry?
Well, I was going to say, before we jump on to the next news item, I wanted to mention something that isn't in on your playlist.
Oh, yeah?
What? So moving away from the running order?
We're gonna move away from Dominic's running order here. I didn't want the show to run out of us. We're already over an hour.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So, hello, everyone. What we have here is the very first North American charging standard to CCS adapter. Okay, it's not available yet. It's made by a Canadian company called A2Z. And it's kind of useless right now because nobody has, the agreements aren't made with the manufacturers to authenticate it. So I could roll up to a NACS, you know, a Tesla supercharger with my Lightning, plug this in, it'll plug in fine. But the supercharger is then going to try to talk to my Lightning and say, you know, hey, who are you and how do I bill you? And it's going to get, you know, a blank no response. So I'm going to really soon have probably the CEO of this company come on and do a short interview with me. And I'm going to talk about this adapter. Right now, they're currently in negotiations with multiple auto manufacturers to get this. That's the company there. But I don't think you can find it on the website yet. I don't think they're selling it yet because you can't use it.
Oh, it says discover, so that you can't buy it, but you can discover. Yeah. So yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So they're calling it the Typhoon plug. So they're speaking with many manufacturers right now. They've given them a bunch of these and they're testing them out. They want to be like an approved adapter. You know, we've talked about this in the past. I did a video on adapter safety, you know, a few months ago on how the major networks don't want you using adapters that aren't certified and provided or sold through the manufacturer. So A2Z is working on getting this as the, like an official adapter. They appear to have high confidence that they will. This thing's been done for almost a year. So they didn't just come out with it yesterday. They finished it and started building them in December of last year and providing them to OEMs. So this isn't something that just came out. It's rated for up to 1,000 volts. It can deliver up to 250 kilowatts. It's IP54 rated. It's got a kill switch, dual kill switch, temperature switches inside. The only thing I kind of don't like, it's hard for you to see under here. See here, this is a lock that locks the NACS connector to here, which is great to have a lock, but it's a manual lock. When you put the NACS connector in it, you then have to take this and slide it forward to lock the connector so it's not able to be just pulled out. Right. I don't like that. I think people are going to forget to do it or whatever. So
will it work if you don't latch it?
I don't know. I'm going to find that out more when I do. I'm going to do like a bit of an interview with the company. I'm going to talk about this really soon. That'll be up on my channel. But you know, the goal of this was for the company. And the funny thing is, when they reached out to me and said, look, we'd really like to send you one, the first thing they said was, you know, we watched your adapter safety video and that's why we're reaching out to you. And, you know, they kind of said to me, you know, a lot of the adapter companies out there are really like grinding their teeth at that video, you know, and they're not happy with you, but I wanted to engage you. They said, you know, and I told them, I said, look, I'm all into safety. And, you know, if you get this thing safety certified, if it's approved by the manufacturers, and we have it out there with a bunch of companies. Our goal is to have it as the approved adapter. Number two, it's in the process of safety certification now, which got me thinking, I wonder how they can like, ETL or UL, whoever's doing safety certification. I wonder how they do that. When you think about it, you can't use it. Like the vehicle has to be authorized from Tesla, and Tesla has to authorize that for it to get approved. So how do they test it other than take it apart and make sure that all the connections are you know, of high quality and can withstand the amount of current that's going to go through it? But as far as physically testing it, they would have to have Tesla and another OEM on board to have an agreement to authorize a specific VIN of a vehicle that they have to be able to run power through this thing. Otherwise, you can't run power through it. You know, so, or I mean, I guess they could, but they'd have to, ETL or UL, who's ever doing it, would have to make an incredibly complex thing. I guess, well, they'd have to have a NACS adapter on one side, a CCS adapter on the other side, and, you know, that doesn't have an authentication process, and just run the power through it for continuous hours and so forth. And I mean, I guess they could build something like that, and that this company would have to pay ETL or UL to build something like that. That would have tens of thousands of additional dollars to build some kind of a machine that just runs power through it. But in any event, I've got one here. I wish I could review it. I can't because I can't use it. But this is what these things are going to look like, guys. This is, you know, this is what the adapters, I'm sure other companies are going to have slightly different versions of it, but basically it's got to look like this. It's got to plug into a CCS1 charge port.
Yep.
On this side, it has to accept the NACS connector, and it's got to have the locking pin for the top that automatically shuts off charging as soon as this gets touched. And then it has to have something that tethers the NACS connector to this unit, because don't forget, in the vehicle, when you're charging a Tesla vehicle, there's a little pin that when you put the connector in, the pin comes up and goes into the recessed part of the adapter, and that doesn't allow you to pull out. So this would have to have some kind of a smart mechanism to do that. And it doesn't. It has this tab that you push back and forth. So let's see. I'm going to do some more work on this, but this is the very first one that was made. And the company seems to have very high expectations that it's going to be approved and done. And Robert says, any temperature monitoring in that adapter? It shuts off the charging at 90 degrees Celsius. There's two points in here that if they reach 90 degrees Celsius, it stops charging.
Well, speaking of going to NACS and using adapters, we heard this week that Jaguar has finally made the decision to leap, the jump. What do Jaguars do? They leap at the NACS. There's not a whole lot to say about this, because at this point, you know, just about everybody else has already jumped on the NACS bandwagon. I think we're only looking at Lucid, who can't really get great charging on the superchargers anyway right now because of the 800 volt system. Hyundai and BMW, I think, are still saying they're studying it. Yeah, but pretty much
there's others still dumb. There's everybody hasn't gone yet. They all will, but you know, there's still Volkswagen hasn't.
Right, Volkswagen is the other one. They say they're studying it, right?
Yeah, so, and they're all going to. They have to. It's not even their decision at this point. They just have to switch over. So
yeah, there's a website, evstation.com, has a list of who's in actually right now. They have like a NACS adoption tracker, which is great. I guess you can sort that out by automaker. So I've got 16 automakers on this list.
To me, I wouldn't even bother building something like that out, because they're all going to be on the list soon. It's like,
once
the vehicles start getting pumped out with the NACS as the native inlet, like, you know, when Ford and GM and everybody who's committed in 2025, those vehicles start rolling out, and if everybody's not on board by then, boy, it's a bad decision from those companies. But
yeah, you know. But it sounded like they were going to make this retroactive, though. So if you have an iPace, there's a possibility that you will get an update, a software update, to allow you to change. I don't know. You didn't see. I don't know. I saw a lot of talk about the iPace yesterday, and they show it on the Jaguar website. The iPace is the only electric vehicle that Jaguar makes at the moment, and they won't be making it.
They're
discontinuing it. Yeah, they won't be. They won't be making this when this switch really happens. They've signed an agreement with Tesla to provide drivers of its next generation electric vehicles with access to the supercharger network in the US, Canada, and Mexico. All new Jaguars sold in the region from 2025 will have full integration of the North American charging standard without the need for an adapter. Then it also says Jaguar will also source adapters from Tesla and support the supply of these to I-PACE drivers once available. So it sounds to me like the I-PACE will have access to superchargers as well, which is great because, you know, there's probably the I-PACE doesn't get a lot of love and probably for some good reasons. I mean, I believe it had some pretty clunky software issues at the start.
That got fixed.
Yeah. But yeah, and it's got some, it does have lots of good characteristics. You know, right. I was just thinking of its off-roading. When they first presented it, debuted the vehicle, they took a journalist off-road with it and they were wading, you know, streams up to, I think it was up to 33 inches or so of stream depth or water depth. But anyway, yeah.
Because that's what most Jaguar owners do.
Right, right. After coming back from the mall, you had to ford the river, right? Yeah. But anyway, I think there's some, like the Audi e-tron, I'm not sure if there's like that level of great value going on right now. I haven't had a chance to look, but it's definitely one of those vehicles that, you know, would suit some people. I like the I-PACE personally. But anyway, we can move along. There's another vehicle that came to the market this week, but it's not fully electric, but I thought we should at least mention it real quick. See, 2025 Ford Ranger plug-in electric vehicle has debuted for Europe, though it's not coming to the U.S. that we know of yet. So this is a plug-in hybrid electric vehicle. It only has 28 miles of range, but maybe for Europe, that's enough. Is that enough, Martin?
Yeah, probably. As long as people charge it overnight, it's probably okay. I'd like to see some bigger batteries going into these hybrids, but it's... Yeah, real life, real world, load it up. It's cold. It's going to be 15 miles. So we'll wait and see.
Okay. Yeah, there's not really a whole lot to say about this. It's not all electric, and I didn't really spend any time digging into it because it's, you know, I don't know. I'd like to see a good 40, 50 miles on a plug-in hybrid before I really kind of take them seriously. Or this
50
this
miles be, should be the base.
Right?
The least and, should be 50 miles today. I mean...
Right. I believe the Volkswagen just launched the Tiguan, which is a plug-in hybrid version of the Tiguan in Europe, and it's got 62 miles of all-electric range, which is, you know, great. But the Ranger is such a big vehicle, you know, I thought we should mention it.
Absolutely. Yeah, although probably too small for you.
I have one in my garage.
Oh, you do? Okay, well, there you go. So that's perfect then.
From 1988.
It's even a lot smaller than this.
It's a lot smaller than that.
It's a little bit smaller than this one and better looking too, I think. But that's just my personal opinion. So I do some...
Vehicles like this, I think, probably serve a purpose with people who use them, because we don't have trucks, so truck culture here, but who use these kind of vehicles, a bit like... you know, vans, there is definitely a section of the truck buying public out there who need to be convinced of electric, and 2 or 3 years in a plug-in hybrid means their next one will be full electric in the middle of the decade. So this probably will serve a purpose. We know that the days of the plug-in hybrid can be gone if car makers want it to be gone, but it probably does a job pretty well to convince those people who will drive around on electric and go, oh, it's just like a normal truck. So
Urban asks, can't wait for this one. Any news on fully EV pickup for you for EU from any manufacturer?
I believe there is one.
Hyundai doesn't, are they doing something with a pickup truck?
Oh, I imagine. Maybe. No, there is one. It's made by... what's the commercial brand that Geely... Is it Geely own that one?
Oh, right.
SAIC. What is it?
We can look for it and come back to it.
That's it. Maxus.
Maxus.
Yeah, okay. There's a Maxus. There's the Maxus one over here. It's really bad. It's got the analog dials for the speed. It's got like the analog dial for the fuel tank, the petrol tank. And it just shows, like, that's like EVs of 15 years ago. It's brilliant. It's awful. And and if you look with the Maxus truck as well, if you look underneath it, it's literally just the battery pack. And you think, oh, there'll be like skid blocks. There'll be a protective steel plate over it. It's like, oh, there's the battery.
I'm surprised they can sell that to you like that.
It must be safe. It is pretty rough and ready. And it's quirky as well. It's like the MG ZS EV that we've still got, the original version of it. It won't AC charge unless the doors are locked. And there was that. There was that other one. There was other Chinese EV, wasn't there, over the last couple of weeks in Germany? And the German car regulator, we don't get it here, said, you know, you can pull the charge plug out when it's charging. And they're like, oh, we're going to issue a, you know, people were pulling the plug out. And it was arcing and no one got hurt. Oh, there'll be a software update coming for that. So it's the worst of Chinese EVs, as in,
right,
we made a thing. If it's good, you like it. If it's terrible, tough, we made a thing. But yeah, there is an EV truck that you can get. And actually, it's not bad.
I don't know, Martin.
No, it's quite bad, it's actually. Really bad. But they did it. They made a thing, and they put it on sale here as the Maxus. And Aussies get it as well. And it's a sister brand to Maxus. And in the comments, you'll know. But they get the same vehicle as well. And Ute culture is bigger down under than truck culture here. So. Yeah.
I think there was another one called like the RD6 or Radar RD6. Yeah, that's right. The one.
Yeah.
That's another one. But I don't think is that coming to Europe?
I haven't heard.
It's a Geely brand, the Radar.
That's right. Yeah, I haven't heard about whether that's coming.
But that's another one, I guess, to keep an eye on. But yeah, we should move on to something else that you can get. Actually, so I got some good news today and bad news on the Brightdrop commercial vehicle, like they make the big panel vans that FedEx has bought some. So the bad news is that the Cami assembly where they're being built will take downtime beginning in October due to previously announced delays in battery module supply. Vehicle production is expected to resume in the spring of 2024, supported by the launch of Cami's new battery module line, which will have capacity to fully support Brightdrop production at Cami and supplement EV production at other GM plants. So, GM really kind of ran into some snag with a supplier. They have some, I'm not sure what the exact issue is, but it has to do with their ability to battery modules together. That's not happening. So, man, this van, which is like pretty awesome, Kyle drove it, he loved it, is they can't make them right now. I mean, but they are taking pretty good corrective steps, I believe, if they have the module manufacturing on that site in particular. So it seems like they have a plan going forward, but for now they're kind of screwed for a few months. But the good news is that if you've been wanting to drive one yourself, you can now rent a Brightdrop Zevo 600 from Ryder. It's just received the first of maybe 4,000 trucks it plans to add to its fleet by 2025. I think they have the initial batch was like 200 vehicles, I believe they bought, but I'm not sure how many they've received yet, but there are at least two, because we can see them in this picture with the Ryder logo on. And they look great, actually. I just want to mention that. I mean, we've seen them with FedEx colors and stuff on them, and they look fine. But this red kind of fading, and I don't know, it looks not so bad, actually. Because that was one of the kind of things that, you know, when this Brightdrop vehicle first came out, we were thinking the styling. You know, it's a commercial vehicle, it doesn't really need styling, but if you look at like what Rivian is doing with the Amazon van, they look so friendly and cuddly, you know. Anyway, I kind of like the way these looks, but so they don't know how many, we don't know how many they've received so far, but they should be available at four different locations. Now, if you're interested in writing these down, write this down, because I might go to one of these locations next week, actually, if I can, or in 2 weeks, and see if I can do something there. But so there are some at in Southern California at Santa Fe Springs location, in Northern California in Hayward, the Dallas-Fort Worth area has some, in Saginaw, that's a little suburb there, and also Long Island City in New York State. So those are the where you can find the first, you know, few of these. That's going to be a unique experience. Tom, you're not far from Long Island City, are you? You get some.
You're unmute myself. Yeah. No, I'm not.
Yeah, and maybe you have some a need for some delivery stuff. I know. I understand you've been doing a lot of renovation and stuff recently.
Oh God, yeah. I'm renovating the house, so
right.
I've been using the Lightning a lot. I'll tell you that for loading. That thing's been. I got to start taking more pictures of me when it's all loaded up with lumber and insulation and everything.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I'm not far from that. And that would be cool. Maybe to reach out to these guys and see if I can, you know, go over there and really get a full tour of it.
Yeah. I was thinking, but just like trying to do it as like renting. A customer. Yeah. Like calling up Vance and saying, hey, I'm going to be, you know, can I rent on this day in like a week and a half or whatever? And see,
well, it's not that close. Okay.
Oh no, it's going to be, well, I was planning on driving up to Colorado. So this is like along the way.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, this would be kind of a nice little stop to make. And yeah, maybe if I can't, I'm not sure how much they charge. I don't want to spend a ton of money.
Probably be spending a lot.
I'm kind of poor right now. Yeah, I can at least maybe have a chance to get up close and personal and take a good look at it.
That'll be good. That'll be good. Yeah. I saw in my notifications that Marques Brownlee, Tom's new best friend, MKBHD, he has a car review channel called Autofocus. That's the best name ever. And he put a video out of the Amazon van yesterday. So let's see how many views. What is the interest in? He's probably going to ding us for copyright now.
Don't show the moving video.
So that's had 407,000 views in less than a day. So there is interest in this kind of vehicle. Very, you know, in anything he does as well is going to be huge. But that's really interesting that there is, you know, a video about an Amazon van. And okay, it's Marques doing it, but like that's really cool. That's a lot of views.
Yeah, I like that. I actually need to watch this because I want to get his impressions on driving it. A lot of our viewers know that I used to work for FedEx and drive the style of van myself. And yeah, I'm rubbing my hands together just thinking about getting behind the wheel and going for and see how it compares to my experience previously. Yeah. But see, where are we? We have to go pretty soon, but there are a couple of things I wanted to mention real quick. Tom's got to go soon too. Just real quick, yeah. Production electric go-kart, a go-kart you can buy, set a new world record over 100 miles an hour. So if you like speed.
No, nothing, I'm not doing it.
I'm saying there's nothing quite like going 100 miles an hour with your butt like an inch off the ground.
Wow.
I had a go-kart years ago that could go like 25 to 30 miles an hour, and it felt like 80. I can't possibly imagine that. I mean, that's like, you know, I think a go-karts for like, you know, teenagers or, you know, young teens that fun to play around with. If you live in a rural area, I did, and I loved the go-kart. I went everywhere in that darn thing. But like more than 30 miles an hour, I'm telling you, when you're sitting on the ground, that's nuts. I mean, this is like, professional like racing, you know,
even on a track.
It's in the go-kart you'd hand your son the keys to and say go have at it, you know.
No, but so go-karts are really popular in training young people for professional careers in motorsport. So if you want to be a Formula One driver one day, this is kind of the level of equipment that you want to train on, I think. Yeah, that's just it's kind of amazing where they've come. There was a really interesting electric go-kart company in the U.S. in California. But I might say like 8 years ago, I think Richard Hillman, I believe, had a company that was making some really nice go-karts. I'm not sure. I guess it never panned out. They did it for a few years and had some racing going on. It was pretty interesting. And I'd kind of like to see more of that. I'm not sure what the interest level is in go-kart racing nowadays, but you know, I know it's a pretty fun activity.
Karting is absolutely part of the single-seater feeder ladder into all the various, you know, ultimately Formula One. But yeah, karting is still huge over here in Europe. Absolutely. It's a key part of how kids get into single seater racing. Right. And then go into either whatever sports cars or, you know, formula racing or that kind of thing. So yeah, absolutely.
Right. So
and actually going electric, sorry, is so crucial on costs. So I know we've got to go, but so crucial on maintenance of these vehicles and costs and all these kind of things. And yeah, so it's not teaching kids how to fix an engine, but will they ever be doing that in the future? Anyway, so not yeah, likely. Absolutely. So brilliant.
One last little thing before we go. So older Tesla Model 3s like mine, I believe it's from Tesla Model 3s produced prior to 2021 with a manual lift gate in the back or a trunk. Tesla is now offering an $800 powered lift gate retrofit. So $800, you take your car to the service station, they do that, pays for the parts and the installation, but it's sold out. It was just announced and boom, it sold out fast. But it's something to keep an eye on. I imagine it's going to come back to the Tesla store pretty quick or pretty at some point. It's hard to say the timeline, but if there's something you like, apparently some people are pretty interested in it already. So I just thought I'd throw that out there. So that brings us to the end of our show. If you have any questions or comments, please leave us a comment below or get in touch with us on Twitter, where we are Batteries Inc. Pod, or on Threads, where we are Batteries Included Podcast. You can follow Martin on Twitter or Threads at EV News Daily. On Twitter, Tom is at Tomologs, that's with two M's, and Tomologny on Threads. I'm Domenick Yoni on Threads and in real life. So don't forget, if you like the show, please give us a thumbs up, click subscribe, tap that bell icon for notifications. Thank you all very much for joining us. We really appreciate having you here with us, and we'll see you all again next week. Ciao.